Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Haunting of Nelson Street, The Ghosts of Crowford, Book 1, by Amy Cross, narrated by Hannah Burman. Prologue, 1 year ago. Alone in her car, as rain crashed down all around, Daisy Johnson stared straight ahead and tried to keep herself from screaming. Waves of rainwater washed down the windscreen, casting dull shadows against Daisy's face as tears welled in her eyes. Since parking in the driveway half an hour earlier, Daisy had barely moved an inch. She felt as if her bones were about to burst out from her body, as if a great wall of anguish and horror was about to erupt and tear her to pieces. At the same time, she told herself that she couldn't possibly keep herself together for much longer. She'd been holding in a scream for hours now, and she was finally on the verge of letting it out. Suddenly, hearing a tapping sound, she turned to her right and saw that a figure was outside the car, already soaked in the rain. A moment later, the figure crouched down, and Daisy saw her husband's concerned face peering in at her. "Daisy!" he called out, his voice barely audible over the sound of so much bad weather, his face distorted by the drops that were crashing down against the window. "Are you okay? How long have you been sitting out here? When did you get back?" She stared at him, and for the first time in 3 years of married life, she felt horrified by the sight of the man she loved. Richard was a good person, she knew that, and he didn't deserve any bad news. She tried to imagine how he might react to what she had to tell him, and she felt her heart break at the thought of his shock. She could try to sugarcoat things, she could try to soften the blow, but deep down she was certain that all her efforts would be in vain. He was safely on the other side of the glass for now, out in the storm, but soon she was going to have to face him. Soon she was going to have to tell him everything. "Daisy, can you open the door?" he asked, trying the handle but finding it locked. He tapped again on the window. "Daisy, please, you're starting to worry me. What's going on? Did something bad happen?" She opened her mouth to reply, but in that moment a knot of tension broke in her chest and she began to sob, huge smothering cries of pain and grief. She put her hands over her face as her shoulders began to heave, and now she genuinely believed that the waves of sorrow were going to be too much for her, that she really might be on the brink of shaking apart and falling into nothingness. She tried one final time to hold herself together, but she could already feel the moment of surrender coming. The scream was forcing its way up through her throat with the relentless drive of a fist. "Daisy!" Richard shouted, trying the handle more furiously now. "Open the door, Daisy! What's wrong? Daisy, what?" Finally, putting her hands on the side of her head, she surrendered and she screamed. Chapter 1. Today. "This is it. This is it. See the sign up there? Nelson Street. We're here." The car eased slowly around the corner and then rumbled along between cars parked on either side. Peering out the windows, Daisy and Richard Johnson looked out at the row of terrace cottages, watching the numbers until finally they found a parking spot, miraculously, right outside numbers 14 and 15. The car came to a halt, and then a moment later, Daisy unbuckled her seatbelt and stepped out into the middle of the road while staring at the beautiful, bright red front door of number 14. She hesitated, and then a faint smile crept across her lips. "What do you think?" Richard asked as he climbed out from the other side of the car. "It's beautiful," Daisy replied, and for a moment she was genuinely in awe of the old, compact two-bedroom cottage that she'd hitherto only seen in photos. "I mean, wow, look at it. We're actually going to live here." She turned and looked across the roof of the car toward her husband. "We're actually going to live here?" she asked, as if she could barely believe the good news. He nodded. It's so cute, she continued. Welcome to the seaside, he replied, stepping around the car as he held up the keys, which he quickly deposited in her hands. Smell that air. Bit different to London, isn't it? He kissed the top of her head as she looked back toward number 14, and then he put an arm around her. They were still standing in the middle of the street, but there seemed to be no danger of them getting run over. Nelson Street was a couple of 100 meters long, tucked away just back from the centre of Crowford, and maybe 200 meters at most from the seafront. But there were very few signs of life. A recycling bin here, an open window there, but otherwise the street was very calm, almost bare. They both knew that if they stood in the street outside their old flat in Chiswick, they'd have been flattened several times over in a matter of seconds. And the other one, Daisy said after a moment, before turning and looking over toward the other row of houses. Is that? She immediately spotted number 15, a dark and derelict house with boarded up windows. That's the other one, Richard said, turning with her and holding up a second set of keys. That's the one that's going to require a little tender, loving care. It looks like a bomb hit it. Not quite, he replied. A fire. Amazing, isn't it? For the money we got selling that cramped little flat in London, we were able to buy 2 cottages down here in Crowford and still have some spare change left over. Makes you wonder why we spent so long in the rat race, doesn't it? That cottage is going to need a lot of work, Daisy murmured. Which is why, he said, carefully turning her back around to look at number 14 again, we're not going to even look at it for at least a day or two. Now, Mrs. Johnson, will you allow me to show you into our new humble abode? This is the dressing room, Daisy said a short while later, as Richard let her go on ahead into the large wardrobe-lined room at the top of the house, like a whole room just for getting dressed in. I bet you still managed to fill every nook and cranny inside of a week, he told her, watching as she turned and looked all around. Remember that cramped little cupboard we had in the flat? These wardrobes are so big, you could almost live in them. Heading to just one of the wardrobes, Daisy pulled the doors open and looked inside at all the empty hangar space. It's huge, she said, genuinely shocked. I know the brochure had all the measurements, but I guess I didn't really take in just how much space we're getting here. Richard, we're going to have to go and get more furniture. The stuff coming from London isn't going to be nearly enough to fill this place. It'll look ridiculous. There's time for that, he said, wandering over to join her. We have to find some vintage shops, she continued. What if we meet people here and make friends? We can't invite them over until the place looks respectable. The furniture's coming this afternoon and... But we'll need more, she said, interrupting him, and now she was starting to panic a little. It's almost too big. Richard, we need to really sit down and work out exactly what we're doing here. This house is so nice. It demands to be handled with taste and care. I really think we should look into hiring an interior designer. We can do all of it ourselves. He put his hands on the sides of her arms. There's no, I'm going to have to throw out the plans I drew, she stammered. The dresser can't go in the main bedroom. It'll have to go in here and then we'll need something else for the bedroom. There's no need to rush, he said, before planting a kiss on her forehead. This is a new start, remember? For both of us, a new town where nobody knows us. She sighed. A new beginning, he added softly. We can do everything at our own pace. But if we invite someone over, who are we going to invite? We don't know a soul in Crowford. By the time we do, we'll have the house looking perfect. Don't you remember the whole idea here? One house that's perfect and all ready for us to live in, and one that needs work before we can rent it out to holidaymakers. He glanced past Daisy toward the window and saw number 15 across the street. Speaking of which, he added, I know I said we'd leave it be for now, but I really should pop over and just make sure everything's safe in there. I'll be 5 minutes tops. I'll come with you. No, you won't, he told her. If you had a minor freakout about this place, you'd probably have a coronary if you saw what it's like over the road. I'll take you over to have a look tomorrow, but for now I think you should just stay here and worry about where to put all the stuff that's arriving later. he kissed the top of her head again before patting her on the shoulder and then heading to the door. Sit tight, and then we should head into town and get some lunch before the van arrives. What about? Her voice trailed off. Richard was already hurtling down the stairs, and a moment later she heard him hurrying out the front door. For a moment she stood all alone in the dressing room and tried to work out where to start. Despite everything Richard had said, she was already trying to figure out how to fill the house. Her sense of panic had faded at least, but her mind was racing and she felt utterly incapable of relaxing or sitting tight. Finally, realizing that she should probably start in the main bedroom and work from there, she turned to go out to the hallway. And that's when she noticed the little corpse on the floor, almost hidden by the open door. She hesitated for a few seconds, not quite believing what she was seeing, and then she stepped closer and crouched down. A dead mouse, no more than 5 or 6 centimetres long, lay on its side on the carpet. Disturbed by the sight, Daisy reached into her pocket and pulled out a tissue, which she used to protect her fingers as she took hold of the mouse's tail. Lifting the dead creature up, she saw to her surprise that its neck was clearly broken, with fresh blood soaked through the fur around its front legs. Chapter 2. A mouse scurried past the trailing end of a piece of burned wallpaper before disappearing into a hole in the skirting board. Pushing the door open, Richard stepped into the dark hallway of number 15 Nelson Street. He stood in the doorway for a moment, silhouetted against the bright street, and then he switched on the flashlight he'd brought from the car. He let the door swing shut as he stepped out across the wood and broken glass that littered the floor. With the windows having long since been boarded up and the power having not yet been reconnected, a flashlight was the only illumination in the entire house. "Nice," he muttered as he slipped the keys back into his pocket. Already, as he made his way through to the ruined front room, Richard's mind was filled with ideas. He had been making plans for weeks, but now it was easier to figure out a proper to-do list. The house had been ravaged by fire some years previously, although structurally it remained sound. The interior, however, had been left as nothing more than a charred mess, with only a few patches of exposed floorboard and some scraps of wallpaper giving any indication of what number 15 had been like as an actual home. From what he'd read, Richard knew that the fire had been tragic and appalling and horrific. It had, however, also opened up some opportunities. Glancing over his shoulder, he looked at the wall he'd already decided to get rid of. He had his heart set on the idea of an open-plan house, with as few dividers as possible. He was already confident that this particular wall wasn't load-bearing, that it could be taken out without causing any trouble. And he figured the next step would be to engage the services of a local architect who'd be able to draw up the necessary plans. Making his way over, Richard tapped twice against the wall and heard the telltale sound of wood, and he allowed himself a faint smile. Number 15 was going to be a real project. It was going to take a long time to get right, but eventually it would be a home like no other. It would be the best holiday rental property in the entire town. Suddenly, he heard a tapping sound from above, and he looked up at the blackened ceiling. The sound was already gone, but it had been a distinct double bump that had seemed to come from the room directly above, and it had seemed, in a strange way, to echo his own tapping sound. The space above, Richard knew, was the main bedroom, the room where that woman, what was her name again? Had died. He aimed the flashlight at the ceiling and watched as its light caught the smoke-stained paint. The surveyor had already warned him that the house suffered from several areas where damage allowed the wind to blow through, so he wasn't too worried about the tapping sound, which had obviously been caused by a stray gust. There was really nothing to be concerned about. A mouse scampered out from behind a burned chair, and then stopped and looked around the room, its whiskers were twitching. Reaching the top of the stairs, Richard reached out and touched the damaged wallpaper. Several ashy flakes came away immediately, and he was reminded that the fire had spread throughout the house. For a moment, he tried to imagine the thick black smoke and the flames roaring up the staircase, and then he realised that there must have been screams, and he told himself to focus on the present. He headed over to the nearest door and pushed it open, and then he shone the flashlight into the master bedroom. To his surprise, he saw an old metal double bed had been left in place, and he realised that the estate agent must have gone to great pains to keep that from becoming apparent in the photos. Stepping over to the bed, he looked down at the bare rods and exposed springs, and he felt a shudder pass through his chest as he realised that this must be the bed in which the woman had died. Best not to let Daisy know too many details, he figured. She'd only freak out. Reaching down, he gave the bed a shake. As the metal rods creak, he told himself that he'd be able to come up with some way to get it out of the house, and then he turned to go to the boarded-up window. As he took a step forward, however, he spotted movement on the floor, and he swung the flashlight down just in time to spot a mouse disappearing beneath the bed. Sighing, he realised that this was another thing that he'd have to keep from Daisy. Mice, he felt certain, would not go down well. At least there were no wires for them to chew on. Not yet. Returning his attention to the window, Richard made his way over and leaned close to the slight gap at one side. He'd noticed the gap from outside, where the board seemed to have been knocked slightly askew, and now he found that he could just about peer out and see the other house opposite. He squinted slightly and was able to spot the window of the dressing room. Sure enough, after a moment, he saw Daisy walking past the window, and he smiled as he thought of her still fussing about the furniture. It was good to see her doing normal things again. "And you want to put in an offer for both?" he remembered the estate agent asking, clearly shocked at some point in the past. "Okay, I wasn't expecting that." "We want a place to live in, and a place to do up and rent out," he'd explained. "It'll be pretty convenient if the doer-upper is right across the street." "It certainly is." "Then let's see if we can get the ball rolling," he'd said, filled with optimism. "Let's start with an offer that's 10 grand below the asking price for the two combined. And you know about the history of one of the houses?" "That doesn't bother me in the slightest," he'd told the agent. "I'm not a superstitious guy, although I don't mind if other people are and the price is lower as a result. Now, can we get that offer in before the close of day? Tell them that we're very motivated buyers." Very motivated buyers. That had been something of an understatement, and now Richard allowed himself another faint smile at the absurdity of the previous year's events. Getting out of London had been a good start, but he knew that it wouldn't be quick or easy to fix everything else. Sometimes he felt as if he was treading on thin ice every time he was around his wife. A floorboard creaked behind him and he turned to look, half expecting to find that Daisy had come over to the house to take a look. He waited a moment, listening for any sign of her. But after a few more seconds, he began to realise that he was alone. He shone the flashlight down at the floor and looked out for mice, but all he saw were the bare metal legs of the old bed. Still, he figured, the house was most likely riddled with mice, so he made a mental note to call someone to take care of that problem, preferably before Daisy found out. "It's a brave man who puts in an offer on not one, but two houses his wife hasn't seen yet," he remembered the estate agent saying. "My wife can't make it down here today," he'd replied, "but it's fine. I know she'll love them when she sees them. We both will." Hearing a rumbling sound outside, Richard turned and peered back over at the window. He told himself that there was no need to worry, that the van with all the furniture wasn't due until 4 PM. But a moment later, his heart sank as he peered out and saw a familiar vehicle rolling past, bearing the removal company's logo. He'd been hoping for a nice, quiet lunch and a chance to relax before all that crap turned up, but now that hope was out of the window. "Great," he muttered under his breath as he turned and hurried out of the room and over to the top of the stairs, just as his phone began to ring. "They're early." Chapter 3. "Move it, Meadows," Sergeant Draper yelled. "If you're not up here in 10 seconds flat, I'll have you doing 100 push-ups with your full kit on." Down at the bottom of the grassy incline, Lance Corporal Meadows stumbled and dropped onto his hands and knees. He took a moment to get to his feet, and then he began to run up to join Draper. Weighed down by his kit bag, he nevertheless managed to reach the top of the small hill just in time. "Pitiful," Draper muttered as he watched the breathless, sweaty mess of a man. "I wouldn't normally be conducting these exercises, but I'm glad I got roped into it today. I'm getting a first-hand view of just how unfit you recruits are." "Sorry, sir," Meadow gasped, doing his best to appear vaguely recovered. Standing up straight, he took a moment to adjust his posture, even as he felt a little weak from all the running. "I'm here now, sir." "I know you're here now," Draper said, rolling his eyes. "Now look around and tell me what you see." "Yes, sir." Turning, Meadows looked at the vast, rolling landscape that stretched out all around them. In all directions, he saw only fields, although after a moment he spotted the shoreline a few miles away and the smudge of coastal properties that constituted the small town of Crowford. "Is that Crowford over there, sir?" he asked. "Is that Crowford?" Draper shook his head. "Where else would it be, man?" "Sorry, sir, I'm just not used to this. The point of this exercise is to simulate a situation in which we're lost behind enemy lines," Draper continued. "We're supposed to keep our heads down and meet up with our fellow units, and it's vitally important that we take the exercise seriously, as if our lives were truly at stake. How would you say we're doing in that regard, Lance Corporal?" "Well, I..." Meadows thought about that question for a moment before putting his hands on his hips and, without realising, letting his posture drop. "Not very well, sir," he continued finally. "Weren't we supposed to meet up with at least one of the other units by now?" "We were," Draper said with a sigh. "But in order for that to happen, you would have had to have been capable of moving at a much greater pace. Tell me, do they not even teach basic fitness these days?" "They do, sir," Meadows replied. "I guess I just started quite a way back." "Here's what we're going to do," Draper said. "We're going to head south. This exercise still has several days left to run, and the priority right now is to avoid the teams who are playing the role of enemy forces. If we can do that, we can find somewhere to take cover, and then we could try to come up with a new strategy. Does that make sense?" "Yes, sir." Draper waited a moment, and then he grabbed Meadows by the shoulders, turned him around, and shoved him forward. "Then let's get moving," he snapped angrily. "You might be a pathetic little thing now, Lance Corporal Draper, but I swear by the time this exercise is over, I'll have made a man of you. But now move." Chapter 4. The door to the Crowford Hoy pub swung open and Mark Lester stormed inside, only to stop as soon as he spotted Steve McKenzie sitting in the corner with a pint and the day's crossword. Steve's dog Mickey was dozing on the floor. "Someone's moving into number 15, Mark announced, his voice filled with shock. "Really?" Steve replied, glancing up at him. "Who?" "Some London types. And it gets worse. They've also bought number 14. "How do you know that?" "I just found out," Mark explained. "And a moving truck just pulled up outside." Steve hesitated before setting his pen down. "How did you let this happen?" Mark asked, stepping over to the table. "You said those houses would never sell. You said we'd never have to deal with this." "There's nothing to deal with," Steve said calmly, once Mark had fetched himself a drink from the bar and taken a seat. "A couple of Londoners have bought the places." "So what? If they want to waste their money, that's their problem. So what? Mark replied incredulously. Are you insane? Those houses have sat empty for 10 years, and we all agreed that it's best if they stay that way. No one was ever supposed to disturb them. Why would Marnie ever have agreed to sell up? There must have been some kind of mistake. There's no mistake, Steve sighed. Whoever these people are, they're probably a pair of idiots with more money than sense who wouldn't notice anything amiss if it was right in front of them. I bet you anything in the world that they're just a pair of harmless idiots. But they're in there, Mark shouted, unable to control himself. I just saw the front doors were open and... All right, keep your voice down, Steve said, reaching across the table and grabbing his collar, then pulling him closer. You don't want the whole pub to hear. He glanced at the bar, where Kay was tapping at her phone, seemingly oblivious to the conversation. It's too late to stop them, Mark hissed. There's been a huge screw-up. Marnie was never supposed to put the houses on the market. There were no signs outside either. We'd all have heard if the houses were going to be sold. He paused for a moment, trying to figure out what was happening. They're in the wrong houses, he said finally. That has to be it. They bought somewhere, but they've opened the wrong front doors. That's not what's happened, Steve told him. It has to be. There's no other... I told you to keep it down, Steve snapped before sighing again. If you must know, I had an inkling that this was coming. How? I heard a while back. He paused. When? At the start of the year, Steve explained. Control of his assets went to some long-lost cousin out in Australia who obviously didn't have a bloody clue about what happened here in Crowford. By the time I heard about it, it was too late to change his mind, and apparently the guy desperately needed the money. I asked around to see if a few of us could discreetly buy the properties up, but it was too late. Some jokers, obviously this couple from London, put in an offer early, and Marnie's cousin didn't wait. The estate agent hadn't even had time to put the damn listings up. And it all went through just like that, Mark asked. Steve nodded. Why didn't you tell anyone? I told the people who I thought could help, he replied, but it didn't work out. Another week and I might have scraped the cash together to gazump them. We're so screwed, Mark said, leaning back and putting his head in his hands. Now that those houses are occupied again, there's going to be another mess. There's not going to be another anything, Steve said firmly. 10 years is a long time, Mark. We've all grown older and the town has moved on. Who's to say that what's in those houses hasn't moved on as well? He paused for a moment, watching Mark's fearful expression. The human soul is bound by flesh and bone while we're alive. But after we're dead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.